Lord. Hallelujah. Did you bring your Bible with you to church this morning? Would you lift it up in the air? Would you wave it from side to side? Would you put shivers on the enemy? Tell your enemy, know that you're armed and very. That you're armed and very. That you're armed and very. Dangerous. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now let us open our word to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. We are going to read from verse 9 until the end of that chapter. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, can I get an amen when you're there? Amen. I don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to try and give you an abbreviated sermon this morning. Our apostle has traveled, he's in Dallas, and I thank God for the opportunity to bring the word of God to you this morning. Hallelujah. So let us read together. The word of God says from verse 9, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. All things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Foods for the stomach and the stomach for foods, but God will destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for body. And God both raised up the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make the members of a harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he says, shall become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, but whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." May our God add his grace and his power to his word this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now, the message that I got this morning was a little rough. And when I got it, I actually got it a couple of weeks ago. It's been developing over the past couple of weeks. And I actually mentioned a little bit at a Bible study on Wednesday. It's a difficult word because it's one of rebuke. If you notice, our apostle, his sermons are mostly encouraging. And I've always asked God, "God, give me a message that is encouraging because I want to encourage the people." But what I find out is that we all have different approaches. God has given us a different calling. Ultimately, we'll get to the same place, but how we deliver the word is going to be different. While he is going to encourage you, I've been given a word of rebuke. Now, amen. It's not rebuke for just, you know, you and not for me. It's for all of us. Can I get an amen on that? Because we're all aspiring to get to heaven. Can I get an amen on that as well? This is why we do what we do. This is the reason why we come to church. This is the reason why we call ourselves Christians. It's because at the end of the day, we all want to go to heaven. Can I get another amen on that? Isn't that why we do all this? It's because simply we want to make it to heaven. But, you know, what we've found out over time is that not everybody is going to make it to heaven. And we want to figure out the reason why. And we also want to find out from God what it is that we need to do to make sure that we make it to heaven. Because the word says, "Many are called and the chosen are few." My friends, you and I have all been called. But the question is, have you been chosen? And whether you're chosen or not will depend on how you live your life before God. Hallelujah. Now, in Christ Citadel, we preached a balanced blend of the kingdom message. That is our motto. We preach a balanced blend of the kingdom message. So that's why we have different personalities. We have different people. We've got the apostle. He's got his style. You've got me. I've got my style. But together, we bring the word of God to you. And ultimately, we hope that that word reaches somewhere and settles somewhere so that we can all live the kind of lives that when Jesus comes back, we're all going to be chosen. Amen. Right? Don't we all want to be chosen? Can I get a show of hands? Who wants to be chosen? Because if you didn't raise your hands, you're going to hell. That's straightforward, right? Can I get any straighter than that? If you didn't raise your hand, that means you don't care. And if you don't care, well, you'll deal with it when the time comes. But anyway, my friends, 2 Timothy chapter 4 says, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort, and with all longsuffering and teaching. So be ready in season and out of season, preach the word. Now, my friends, a lot of times when we see that command, preach the word, we assume that is for pastors, that is for ministers, that's for people who have been called to do the work of God. But my friends, you're forgetting that in Matthew chapter 28, we all received the Great Commission, all of us. Every single one of us has been instructed to preach the word of God. It's not just for pastors, it's not for people who stand behind the pulpit, it's for you. As a matter of fact, I'm looking at you, and there are future pastors in this church sitting in the congregation right now. But the question is, have you heard that call, and have you accepted that call? I was one of those people, the call was on my life, but I ran away from it. But you know what? When God has chosen you, you don't have a choice. Ultimately, he'll get you. Why? Because he sees everything. He sees where you are. He knows everything about you. If our God knows how many hairs there are on your body, then that gives you an idea. He knows absolutely everything about you. He knows all your thoughts. He knows where you're coming from. He knows where you're going. But very importantly, he also knows if you're one of those who's going to be chosen. And this is what we're talking about today. Now, the reason why I call it a very difficult sermon is because when I tell you that God's standards are over here, and you and I are over here, that has a way of discouraging some people. Because if God's standards are over here and I'm over here, that means I won't make it. And God has said in the word, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. He said that in Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 and 13. Can we get that up if you don't mind? Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 and 13. A lot of times, you know, we point our fingers at people, say, you're doing this, you're doing that. But then we're not worrying about ourselves. We're being very judgmental about other people, but we're forgetting that first we need to worry about ourselves first. Worry about your salvation first. Once you're sure that you've got your salvation, then reach out and make sure that somebody else also will receive their salvation as well. So it says in Philippians chapter 2, it says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. So when we say work out your salvation with fear and trembling, it's not to tell you to be worried and stress out and freak out and say, oh my God, there's no way for me to make it to heaven. No, what he's telling you is by actively pursuing obedience in the process of sanctification, actively pursuing his face, actively pursuing God and the kingdom of heaven. Because we know that when we seek the kingdom of God, everything else shall be added unto us. Quite often we make the mistake of being motivated by the blessings, motivated by the miracles, and forgetting the person who is able to perform those miracles in our lives. If we can reach out and touch God and get him first, then everything else that we need will be added unto us. Can I get an amen? So first, primarily, let us seek him who is able to bless us. He who is the source of our blessings. Let's seek him first. And then once we get him, then let's expect everything else that he has promised us. Can I get an amen this morning? Amen. Hallelujah. Now, the trembling in what we just read is the attitude that Christians are to have in pursuing this goal. A healthy fear of offending God through disobedience, and an awe and respect for his majesty and holiness. A healthy fear of offending God. The word says that the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. If you fear God, then everything else that you're seeking will be added onto you. But if you don't fear God and you take him lightly, You come to church, it's praise and worship, you're sitting there looking at people, wondering, what are they doing? Somebody's preaching the word, but your mind is somewhere else. You're thinking about that girl you're going to hook up after the sermon. Or that guy who's sitting over there, he's really dressed well today. My God, I wish I could talk to you. You know something, my friends? These are the end times. Why is it important for us to understand these end times? Why? Because we're supposed to be preparing for the next leg of our journey, the final leg of our journey. They say that for a Christian, this earth is your worst hell. Because when your life is done on this planet, you're going to a better place. Can I get an amen? Amen. So for somebody who's a sinner, who's not a Christian, this world is your best heaven, because it'll never get better than this. As a matter of fact, it'll get a lot worse. So this is why we're talking about this morning. These are the end times. These are the end times. The question for you is this. If Christ comes back today, are you going? If Christ comes back today, are you going? This is a question I'm posing for myself, by the way, as well. Because my biggest fear in my life is to spend as much time as I'm spending in the presence of God and get to heaven and find that my name is not in the book of life. That is my biggest fear. So I'm working out my salvation with fear and trembling. I'm praying to God. I'm saying, God, I pray that I'm one of those people that you know. Yes, I'm here. I'm preaching the word of God. I'm quoting scripture. But what if I get to heaven and he says, you're one of those people, you are preaching the word, but I didn't know who you were. That is my biggest fear. And so, my friends, that's the reason why I said that this sermon has a way of being a discouragement to some. Because there's some who will say, well, if I'm not going to make it to heaven, then why am I trying to live a good life? Why am I doing all these things? Why am I going to church? Why am I going to Bible study? Why am I listening to these sermons? If I'm not going to heaven, I didn't tell you you're not going to heaven. I didn't tell you that, my friend. I never said that. I told you you've got to work at it. If you don't work at it, you won't go. You have to work at it. We all have to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. You know, there's some pastors who won't make it to heaven. And there are some people we're looking at and we're being very judgmental about. When we get to heaven, we'll be surprised to find that they're there. What, you're here? Oh my God, I can't believe it. He is here. What did you do? You know what? This is why we're talking about this right now. Because if Christ came back today, some of us won't make it. If Christ came back, you know, why did this message hit me so hard? Because I was watching a sermon, I was listening to a sermon by a well-known Ugandan pastor, John Mulinde. Actually, my middle name is Mulinde. So this is a man who has traveled far and wide. He gave up his job to go into ministry full-time. His church, Signs and Wonders, they pray for people, people get healed. They see miracles taking place. When you see that, and you're this kind of a pastor who sees miracles, people being healed in your church, aren't you going to say, wow, I got it like that. I'm going to heaven because see what God is doing in my presence. But you know something, we're talking in Bible study about the gifts that are without repentance, meaning that there are some people who are not necessarily living right, but they're preaching the word of God and things are happening. God is healing people. God is doing things in that church. And then you're going to wonder, how is it that this person is not living right, but signs and wonders are taking place in his church? Why? Because God loves his people. Amen. Because God loves his people. God loves his people. He doesn't want to let them down. He's not going to cause the sins of the pastor, right, to cause them to lose their blessing. God loves his people. God loves you. So God is going to hear your prayer. God is going to hear our prayer when we agree. He's going to heal you and do things for you. But the question is, because it did that, does that automatically mean that I'm going to heaven? Right? Because you came and I laid hands on you and you told me, guess what, Pastor? I was healed. I wasn't well. I went to the doctor. The doctor checked and said, this thing is gone. What happened? Right? Is that reason for me to believe that because I prayed for you and God did that, that I automatically am going to heaven? No. It doesn't mean that. So this pastor, Jesus appeared to him in a vision, and Jesus told him, do you know if I came back today, you wouldn't make it? And I thought to myself, oh my God, if this pastor isn't going to make it, then I for sure I'm not going to make it. Because I respect this man. I've heard a lot about him, the things that he's done, the exploits in Jesus' name. If he is not going, what about me? So then I started praying on it. I said, Lord, here I am doing all this. If I'm not going to heaven, why am I even standing on this pulpit? Because if I'm not going to heaven, that makes me one of those false prophets we've been talking about. But then as I was praying on it, especially this morning I was praying on it, and you know, it was a hard message to bring. And I said, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to bring this with conviction. And then in my spirit, I got an answer. Whatever it is you're worried about, take it to God. Whatever it is you're worried about, take it to God. If you're worried you're not going to make it, take it to God. Why? Because God is the one who will give you permission to enter. So go to God, right? Go to God. There's a man of God who came and he said, if you're not sure that you're going to heaven, then you're probably not. And that really hit me really hard. If you're not sure that you're going to heaven, then you're probably not. And that hit me really hard. And then I also realized, you know, there's a lot of people who think they are going to heaven who won't. So if you're not sure, that means you don't have a relationship. If you're not sure. If you're not sure, it means you don't have a relationship. If you don't have a relationship, you're not going. So what am I saying? Start to have a relationship today with Christ. Start to have a relationship today with Christ. Get on your knees and pray. This is my prayer for us today, is that Lord, cover us with the blood of Jesus. Because we know, because we've accepted you as our Lord, that the enemy is on us 24/7. The enemy would love for us to burn in hell with him. That is why it's causing us to stumble. Even men of God stumble. The other day we heard of a man of God, big church, 30,000 people. He overdid on cocaine. And guess what? He happens to be in the same room with a stripper who he was having in a relationship for the last couple of years. So, you know what? This is what I'm saying is that don't see a mega church and automatically think that's where God is. So that's where I need to go because God is there. No. Look for the Word of God. The Word of God is preached in every kind of a church. Even a relatively small church like this, the Word of God is preached in this church. Can I get another amen on this? Right? If you go to a mega church and the pastor is gay, did that shock somebody? What did we just read? We just read in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, homosexuals will not inherit the kingdom of God. I'm sorry to bother you with this, but it's the word of God. And I'm going to preach the word of God without any worry at all, because it's in the word of God, so I've got the right to tell you about it. So if you go to a church where the pastor is a homosexual, it says very clearly here, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. If that is your persuasion, if that is what you've accepted as well. They've also named a couple of other types of people here. Idolaters, fornicators, adulterers, sodomites, thieves, coveters, drunkards, revilers. I mean, the list goes on. But the question for you is, do you fall in this list of people? If you don't, thank God. Because this list covers a whole spectrum of people. And there is a very slight possibility that you might fall in this group of people. And if you do fall in this group of people, you need to get out. Because the Bible told you, you won't make it. You need to get out. So this is why we're having this discussion right now, before Jesus comes back. Because these are the end times. Right? Number one, we need to all develop a relationship with our God. Are you the praying kind of person who has a prayer life outside church? Some people don't. Some people only pray when they come to church. Do you have a Bible reading life? Do you read the Bible? You know, these instructions are in the Word of God. And the Word of God says that my people perish for lack of knowledge. Why? Because they don't read the Bible. They wait to come to church so Pastor Dan can tell you about the Bible. You wait to come to church so Pastor whoever, apostle, whoever can tell you about the Bible. But when you get home, this Bible, you put it on the side and you don't open it until next Sunday. If Jesus came back today, are you sure you'd make it? Really? Because the instructions to make it to heaven are all in this book. The instructions are there, but if you don't read them, then you are in that group of people who will perish for lack of knowledge because you don't read your word. So friends, let us develop a relationship with our God. Do you practice humility? And as I said, I'm out of time, so I'm just going to compress my message. Do you practice humility? If you're not a humble person, you cannot approach God. If you're proud, conceited, these are the things we're talking about here. If you're proud, conceited, judgmental, look, point fingers at people all the time. It's not me, it's you, you, you. You may not make it. There's an instruction in the Word that tells husbands to love their wives. Husbands, do you love your wives? There's an instruction in the Word that says, wives, respect your husband. Wives, do you respect your husbands? Thank you, Mrs. Wilson. Matthew chapter 5 talks about adultery. Matthew chapter 5 talks about adultery. What does it say about adultery in Matthew chapter 5? It says, but I say to you that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Is there a man here who has not committed adultery? I've committed adultery. I have. I've seen a woman and I lusted after her. Are you surprised? I'm a man. I'm not a saint. I'm aspiring to be a saint. But I'm not a saint yet. I'm aspiring. But you know what? We've all fallen short. All men. If you've got red blood running through your veins, you have fallen short. Guess what? The Bible says when Jesus comes back, we're going to have to give an account of everything. All those thoughts, you're going to have to give an account of them. Now you're thinking to yourself, oh man, all my sins, all my life, there are too many, take too long. Guess what? God has got the ability to show you all those sins in a couple of seconds because he's God. And you're going to account for every single one. Every single thought. You know what this pastor said? He was in church and one day this lady came to preach. She was a very attractive lady, you know, and he's sitting there and he's stripping her naked in his mind. Do you know Jesus showed him that thought? Jesus showed him that thought. That thought. So this is my message also to ladies, right? Because in our minds, when you come and you're half dressed, we're going to look at you and lust after you. Why? Because we're men. Let's face it. Let's face it. Okay? Listen, don't come for prayers if your breasts are exposed, because I can't pray for you when I'm looking at your breasts, okay?
Close your eyes.
Close my eyes. Pastor Lara. Okay? You come here, don't, you know what I'm saying? I'm not really coming. I'm just, you know, sometimes the people who come to church and the way they're dressed really just puts us off. Right? It just, the way they're dressed, you know, because, you know, we're men. We're red-blooded. We look and we lust. Guess what? You've caused us to sin. And guess what? We're going to have to answer to God for that. So don't do that. Okay? You can look pretty, you can look nice, but you don't have to come half naked. Listen, if you come to church and you're half naked and Jesus shows up, do you think you'll make it?
No.
Why? Because you're causing us all to sin. If you're causing us to sin, you're not going to make it. So, you know, sometimes people are a little hesitant to talk about this, but look, we want to make it to heaven, okay? So some things we can't ignore. Some things we have to address. When you go to the house of God, you're going to fellowship, you're going to worship God, you're not going to turn men on. That's not your purpose. If you come and turn us on, you will pay for it. Because God sees our thoughts. Even as he's punishing us, he'll punish you too, because you're the one who created them in our minds. Can I get an amen on that? Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now listen, we're running out of time, so hopefully I can continue this sermon some other time, but here's the solution. Here's the solution. If you're not sure right now if you're going to heaven or not, ask God. Ask God. Don't let people tell you, you're not going, you're not going, you're not going. No, I don't let me tell you you're not going. I don't know that. God makes the choices. God's the one who chooses. However, he said some things very clearly in his word. If you don't do this, you won't do this. If you won't do this, you won't make it. So if it's here in this word, I can tell you with surety. If it's here in the word, I can tell you surety, it'll happen to you. If you're not paying attention to where you're supposed to be paying attention to, you won't make it. These are the end times. So let us make an effort. Let us all make an effort to do something different in our lives. Right? Let's make an effort to draw closer to God. Let's make an effort to develop a relationship with our God. As I wind up, I remember the story of David. David and Bathsheba. You remember what happened? Right? Somebody died in the process. Now, how big a sin do you think that was? Isn't that the kind of sin that would condemn you to hell immediately? Why? Because you committed adultery with somebody's wife, and then you caused that man to get killed. Okay? So, then imagine David now, in a moment of weakness. I think maybe the enemy entered him or whatever, caused them to do this. But in the moment of weakness, he did something that could cost him his salvation. So what did David do? Let us turn to Psalms 51. Psalm 51. This is what David did. David humbled himself. David went before God. Psalms 51. In fact, let us read the whole psalm, because in here, it'll give you an idea. We have all fallen short, but it's not, all hope is not lost. All hope is not lost. We have to humble ourselves before our God and make sure he knows who we are. So it says in Psalms 51, let me start from verse 10. Let's start from verse 10, please. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence. Do not take away your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise. For you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. Do good in your good pleasure to Zion. Build the walls of Jerusalem. Then you shall be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with burnt offering and whole burnt offering. Then they shall offer bulls on your altar. Friends, essentially, David humbled himself. He realized the error of his ways. And the way he approached God, even God had to say, yeah, okay, you're my guy. The way he approached God, say, I see that you're repentant. I see that you want a difference. I see that you want me in your life. And God had no choice but to forgive him. So this is our way out. This is our way out. Humble yourself before God and pray forgiveness for your sins. Plead the blood of Jesus over your life so that no matter what you do, you know, we're all asking for a long life. Right? Isn't that what you're asking for? You want a long life. But you know, you've got plenty of opportunities in that long life to do wrong, that you miss out your citizenship in heaven. We want a long life, but you know what? We're also extending the likelihood of doing something that will make us lose our salvation. So we constantly have to be in God's presence. Almighty God, cover me with the blood of Jesus, because we know that the enemy is constantly trying to make me sin. I know that the enemy is constantly trying to make me lose my relationship with you, so that when you come back, I won't be amongst those that you come back for, so that I'll end up burning in the lake of fire with the enemy. Cover me, Lord. So this is my prayer for us today. And I didn't want to discourage you, but I want to encourage you. You know, even the thoughts that we think in church are being watched. Even the thoughts you think in church, you'll be asked about. If they're sinful, If you came to church and you didn't come to do what you came to do, what you should have done, you came, you're doing other things, you're looking at people, fantasizing, having, you know, the Bible says, such as you think is what you are. So your thoughts are so important. You know, you may see me and say, well, Pastor Dan is so holy. I've heard that said, and I'm like, I wish I was. I wish I was. It's not so much in what you see me do, but what about what goes through my head? You know, your thoughts can cause you to lose your citizenship.
Amen.
Your thoughts. So think about your thought life. This is another thing that pastor was told. When you go to bed at night, the thoughts that you think. When you wake up in the morning, the thoughts that you think. You know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. When you wake up in the morning, the thoughts that come into your mind, are they holy thoughts? You know, you'll be asked about them when Jesus comes back. You'll be asked a lot of things, but my prayer this morning, my friends, is that we shall all make it together.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Come on, let's repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the gift of life. I thank you for the blood of Jesus. I thank you for the finished work at Calvary. I invite you into my life today, O God. Change everything around. Wash me clean with the blood of Jesus. Make me worthy, O Lord, to have my name written in the book of life. Because it is my desire that when you come back, Jesus, that I will be amongst those that will come and live with you in eternal peace. In Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Put your hands together for our God. He's an awesome God. Now, if there's anybody who wants us to pray and agree, if you've kind of backslidden, if you've fallen away from your relationship with God and you want us to agree together, you can come up and let's agree. Or if you just want to accept Jesus into your life today so that you can be amongst those who are called and chosen, you can come up and we'll pray for you. Or if you've got a need or a situation, you can come up and we'll touch and agree. If everybody's sanctified, everybody's good today,
amen,
then we're just going to conclude here. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the word. We ask Almighty God that in this life we've got so many challenges and so many temptations, and the enemy is after us left and right. And so, Father, there's so many opportunities for us to commit sin and lose out on your relationship. There's so many opportunities for us, Almighty God, to draw further away from you than we need to be. But we're asking today, Almighty God, that you draw us close to you. Cover us with the blood of Jesus. Surround us with a hedge of protection. So that, Lord, everything that we do will glorify your holy name. So that, Father, we can work on getting closer to you. We pray, Almighty God, that we won't be amongst those, when you come back, who you will tell, I didn't know who you were. Go away from me, you workers of iniquity. We pray, Almighty God, we shall be amongst those that you know. So help us, Almighty God. If you don't help us, we can't make it. So we're asking you, our God, today to help us. Help us, Lord, to live the kind of lives that please you. Help us, Lord, to live the kind of lives that will guarantee that our names are written in the book of life. Help us, Almighty God, to release the pleasures of this world. And help us to embrace the pleasures of heaven. Because, Almighty God, we know that these are the end times and we need to be working on our relationship with you. So we pray, Almighty God, that, Father, you protect us. Protect us from the wiles of the enemy. So that, Father, all that we do, Father, will bring us even closer to you. So that all we do, Almighty God, will bring us into your presence. And, Father, once we're in your presence, do not let us go, Almighty God. Surround us with your presence so that we'll never leave, so that we'll always be where you are, because we know that if we're where you are at all times, Father, we shall come and be with you when this time is up on this planet, Almighty God. So we thank you, we bless you, we pray for this church, Almighty God, that this will be a vibrant church, that this will be a spirit-filled church, this will be a blood-washed church, that everything that we do in this church, Almighty God, will glorify your holy name. That everything we do in this church will come directly from you, Almighty God. Help us not to speak our own imagination, but help us to speak the word of God, Almighty God, because that is what will bless your people, Almighty God. So have your way in this church. Have your way in our lives, Almighty God. And we pray that, Father, in all that we do, you, our God, will receive all the glory and all the honor. All these things we ask and we pray in Jesus' holy name. And all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.